All right, welcome back to Head Start. A member of the Consultative Committee on Charter Change asserts the budget deficit from a shift to federalism will remain within 3% of gross domestic product. Arthur Aguilar, who headed the subcommittee that drafted provisions on national economy and patrimony, says that's because of a proposed federal intergovernment commission which will help lead the shift to a different system of government. Aguilar says that the commission will be led by the budget and finance departments. He adds the DOF and DBM will also be the ones to decide the amount of funds that federated regions will get.
For the federalism to work, you have to have a dedicated authority or an agency that would sort out the problems. The Federal Intergovernment Commission. The membership of that, the main drivers of that, will be DBM and DOF. If the cost of federalization of one particular year is too high, we scale down. We echelon it to further years. In other words, they are in charge of the pace and the cost of the transition of federalization. So the runaway budget deficit would not be possible. There is a natural cap to all of this. We should stay well within 3%.
All right, still with us on Hot Copy is NEDA Planning Secretary Ernesto Pernia. Secretary, your reaction to that? He's essentially a backup, saying that a federal intergovernment commission will help it, the lead, and the DOF and DBM will be the ones to decide the funds.
Well,
it'll remain within the 3%.
Our estimates are based on data.
Okay.
So data-based. So I don't know where they got that estimate of it will stay within 3%. So it's not in the draft constitution that I saw that it will stay within 3%. It's not there.
Okay. Now you became very famous recently for saying that federalism will wreak havoc on the economy.
Yeah. Okay. Let me state very clearly that we, including myself, do not oppose federalism. It may well be the holy grail that we are aspiring for.
Well, that's a big shift from you.
I want to be very clear.
Yeah, go on.
But going to the holy grail takes time. You cannot rush your approach to the holy grail because you have to make a lot of preparations. And that's essentially what we're saying.
Yeah.
We cannot rush there. We need to do a lot of homework, a lot of preparation, so that when we get there, we can really enjoy the Holy Grail is.
Secretary Sonny Dominguez in the Senate hearing with you beside him said he absolutely will not support that draft that the CONCOM made.
No, yeah, if it is voted on today, he said, I will not support.
Okay, what don't you like about it today? Be specific.
Well, the draft lacks analysis and data. It's not data-driven. It's not analysis-driven.
On
the financial aspects, on the economic aspects especially, there's nothing. There's nothing there. It's really just an assignment of revenue, but not the expenditure responsibilities, for example.
Okay.
So, but you know, you have to connect the two.
What were you hoping to see? What would you want to see?
We would like a more analytical. There should be an annex that is that provides the analysis.
Okay. Now you were also quoted as saying that the shift to federalism will directly cost the government 120 billion pesos. How did you come up with that computation?
That is our estimate. That is the preliminary estimate of NEDA. We are working on that some more to make it more firm, estimate.
Okay.
But that is a ballpark estimate.
But on what grounds were the 120 billion?
Based on the needed expenditures for, there are going to be 400 senators, right? Congressmen.
I don't know, congressmen.
400.
Yeah, and something like 30
something. There'll be 32 senators per region, so 38.
36.
38 then.
Or 36, 18, 36, 18 36. 18 times 2
That's
each.
Correct, 30,
yeah. 36. I see, go on.
And so there'll be regional assemblies, and there'll be different courts
I
for
see.
Different regions. And, you know, so it's going to cost a lot more.
Uh-oh. So no, but what you're saying is the 120 million was not a figure you guys just dreamed up of. You really did the math.
And also the need to construct new buildings for this new system of government. New buildings and more vehicles purchased for service of the, you know, the different officials of the regional government. So that those are the things we had inputted into our analysis.
Okay. Now,
but that is just financial cost. Yeah. We are not even talking about the economic cost in terms of externality, negative externalities on the economy.
Oh, like meaning, what are those? Explain.
Well, our momentum, economic growth momentum, will be disrupted because it's a different system. And, there's some uncertainty too among investors. The business group has already come out with a statement. So, you know, those things will affect our growth momentum.
Okay.
And the build program will also be affected. The momentum of our build program, many of those projects would have been completed by the end of the term of President Duterte. At least 32 projects we expect. 32 out of the 75 flagship projects we expect to complete by the end of this administration.
Yeah.
And then the rest will have been started but not completed maybe beyond 2022.
Is Secretary, given that you are the economic development planning czar of the whole country, is there any way to address the concern of provinces, regions, regarding that, you know, if we had our own funding, we would actually grow more instead of Manila being so centralized, deciding on everything. If it's not the federal, if it's not the shift to the federal form, what immediate solution can be given where you can have the local government units?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, of the 79 flagship projects, the majority are in the regions.
Okay.
Region-specific or inter-regional connectivity. And apart from the 75 flagship projects, we have 4,900 projects specific to the provinces, to the municipalities, to the cities, to the regions.
Yeah.
So if we complete our build program, many of these regions will have been addressed in terms of infrastructure deficit, in terms of human capital deficit.
So you don't need federalism for that?
Well, these are the things we should do first.
Yeah.
This is all we're saying.
Yeah. But,
and then, you know, then we'll be better prepared for federalism.
If the government stuck to the Philippine Development Plan, do you think that would be the answer?
Well, that was our intention when we started in the government. When we started in this administration, we crafted a Philippine Development Plan 2017 to 2022, and this is a people's plan actually, because there's a lot of consultation not only among all agencies were involved, all agencies of government involved. We had consultations at the regional level, at the local level. We had consultations with the private sector. We put it on the website, our draft of the PDP, Philippine Development Plan. So and then we welcome comments.
Yeah.
And before we finalized the document, we took into account all those comments.
I'm curious if you've ever said this to the president up close. Or face
no, the president
face.
Knows that because he endorsed that
the plan.
The
no,
plan.
But even the effects of federalism in terms of cost.
Well, he knows it by now, I'm
he
sure.
He does. Yeah. Okay, all right. Now, earlier, just this because you've given the connection on what it may cost the country economically with federalism, is there's something at least that we can predict, which is in 2018, a 4.8%. Inflation rate on the average, but still, let's not forget, this is still way above government targets, which was 2 to 4%.
Yeah, it's way above the upper end of
yes.
our.
Yes, in fact, it's gone beyond the upper
end. Correct.
So
that's correct.
Now that 4.8% is the average target for 2018, how will this affect growth rates?
Okay,
because we've already hit 6%.
Yeah.
We're talking about 6%. From April to June, which is the weakest in the last 3 years.
So it's It's an average of 6.3% for the semester, for the first 6 months.